Hey, guys, you need to watch the videos that I'm about to show you where MK Political Party and EFF, they are doing the most in Parliament, brying them. You know what I'm saying? Now you get to see why they really hate EMK Party and EFF. You know now good why they don't like EFF, because if you listen to EFF and the MK Party this time... Oh, what are those guys? They know why they are in Parliament. Well, let me give you something. Lest you accuse me of something, guys. Those guys, they understand the assignment. Those guys, they understand the assignment very well. And they are educating other people. You know what I'm saying? Every time when they open their mouth, it's like they are saying, let the class begin. Bambala. Not me. It's MK Party. If you've got a problem, please have a problem with these people.
Greetings, House Chair, Honorable Ministers and Deputy Ministers, Honorable Members, and our fellow officials. May I read the following laws that governed us since then? The Free State Ordinance 5 of 1876, dealing with the rights of colored, precluded them in owning property unless one parent of the person was white. The next one, Franchise and the Ballot Act of 1892, Squatters Act of 1895 in the then Orange Free State, Glen Grey Act of 1894, the Native Reserve Location Act of 1902, the Crown Lands Disposal Ordinance of 1903, the Native Land Act 27 of 1913, which solidified African lands dispossession that dated back to 1800. From 1994 to 2024, the Africans still remain dispossessed of their land. I just wanted to read that part so that I can give my input. My input is that you took our land when we were using our native law, and then you use Roman Dutch law for it to be returned to us, and that is foreign. And Roman Dutch and British law has no jurisdiction in this land.
We will continue to listen to EFF as well. Don't worry. Don't you dare go in, because you need to watch this until the end. It's also been noticeable is that these Afrikaner people in Parliament, they thought, Guti, it's just business as usual, man. These people wouldn't even notice when we rob them. Oh, Ganta Babuzange Langen. MK Party, look. So they get to Parliament and they start speaking Afrikaans. Quickly. MK Party and some of MK Party members and local EFF members quickly resorted to their own mother's language. If you speak this language, we will show you. I'm like, they are fixing EGNU. MK Party, EFF, they are fixing EGNU and the GNU. That's Kuba Leslabaslabang. I'm sure I'm in the bank type Bunganda. What am I in front of it? What an hour they did. What thing gloom is a hang on a pitch in you? Hey, guys, Gazam. I'm not saying what I've got about saying I'm comment section. Gazam. I'm trying my best. But anyway, EMK Party. The EFF, they are not trying their best. In fact, they are doing their best, right? So let's look before we get into MK Party as well. This is what I need you guys to do here. If you are not yet subscribed, what are you waiting for? Come on, good people. Because to subscribe, it is free. To like the video, it is free. To comment in the comment section below, it is free of charge. To click the notification bell, it is free of charge. To share this video, it is free of charge. To watch this video until the end, it is free of charge. Also, good people, I mean, come on, to watch the ads,
It's free of charge, and that's how you financially contribute to this YouTube channel. Speaking about financially contributing to the channel, you can join, become a member of this YouTube channel from as little as 20 rand a month. You can also use the Super Thanks button. In case you don't want to do that, guys, there is a way where you can use my media company banking details to donate to the channel. And you know what I'm saying? We'll bring you more. And also, guys, want to buy more equipment. So the power is in your hands. Please do the honorable thing as we proceed.
Okay. Now, moving right along to EMK Party, there is a video where they continue with what they were saying in the beginning before we can jump into EFF. But it's a very interesting thing, and it is so interesting on how he goes about it and who is pointing as a problem to this, right? It is the very same chairperson. He's like, when you guys got here, right, you use a law that was not, you acquired a land through our law and then introduced a foreign law. Now we are judged by through a foreign law. No, we can't. It's not fair. Take a look at what he said here.
There's no jurisdiction in this land. So there is what we call a legal paradox, where a law that has no jurisdiction in a foreign land being used by the natives to comply. That is impossible. Okay, let me move on. Elu Hatle, in the army base as a Northern Cape. Kuno in Kosilapa Uholele Nototo. In 1911, their land was taken and the army is now based there. But not just the army, also the minerals in their land. That's a richer spot in the Northern Cape. It is a bone of contention today and the matter is not resolved. We are going there to solve that problem. And our land, by the way, I understand, ministers, when you say you don't have money. Money is not with you, the state. The person who's got money is Rupert and Oppenheimer. And there are two guys who are actually monopolizing the South African economy. I can take you back from 1917 when Ernest Oppenheimer established Anglo-America. Harry Oppenheimer after him, and Nicky Oppenheimer after him. Three generations, in over 100 years, the country is held at ransom and nobody's saying anything about it.
Mina, guys, I'm impressed with a performance MK Party, and EFF so far. It appears like they are approaching this in a very matured way, which is something that is commendable, and let's give credit when it is due. Their approach is very mature as well. Now, there was a man in parliament as well, speaking about maturity, who approached this in a very matured way, and that man is none other than Mbuyiseni Ndlozi, when he said this.
Thank you, Speaker, and Chairperson, and good afternoon, honorable members. Morning. We perhaps as a point of departure must guarantee the people of South Africa that we know of the racist idioms that have sometimes informed white supremacists to think that there is a relationship between polish and the skin pigmentation in the history of South Africa. We're not going to accept those racist practices in these chambers where blood was spilled to confront centuries of racial exclusion and abuse against Black people. This budget, Chairperson, takes place within a broader context of no confidence in the police. The people of Jikulane, the people of Nanda, the people of Delft live under constant fear of well-known criminal gangs, well-known individuals that are doing despicable acts of violence. And at the center of the crime-ridden society in South Africa are two important things that the APP does not address with its appropriation of about 113 billion for SEPs alone. One is the fact that your strategy is not actually committed to prevention of crime. You want to fight crime after it has happened. There is no well-articulated idea of how you are going to stop the murder rate, which is amongst the highest in the world. In the last financial year alone, about 27,500 people were killed, murdered. If you want to understand the dramatic effect of that, in Gaza, there is an ongoing genocide with military bombardment of buildings and people. In the same period, so to speak, since the war started, 38,000 people were casualties. 27,500 in South Africa under so-called peace conditions. In Gaza, where there is a war and genocide, 38,000. You have lost the war against crime. Of the top 30 police stations, if you look at them over the last 20 years, they repeat themselves. You know where murder is taking place. So it means you need a preventative strategy. All those police stations are known coming from only four provinces, KwaZulu-Natal, Gauteng, Eastern Cape, and the Western Cape. There is no strategy here to address that. Same as rape and gender-based violence. 42,000, over 42,000 rapes in the last financial year alone. The police stations are the same. The top police stations are well-known police stations, Sishiyo, Umlazi, Delft. You know where these activities are taking place. They are related to shebeens. They are related to places that are not safe in the streets, in the parks. Your deployment of the budget, your deployment of personnel should be preventative of these crimes. There is kidnapping on the rise. Even members of parliament in this chamber these days get kidnapped. Gangs and drugs, all the drug lords or the drug dealers are known. Only the police claim ignorance. We know the houses in Orange Farm. We know the houses in Kailisha that are selling nyaupe. Only the police don't know. Only the police claim ignorance. The gangsters are embedded with the police. In fact, some of the drugs in our country are transported with police vans because police vans don't get to be searched. And that's another key problem of the failure of crime in this country is the embeddedness of the police service. There is no strategy in here to disarticulate police up to the top generals that are working with criminals, that are working with drug lords, that are on the payrolls of drug lords. Crime intelligence in your budgets account for about 4%. You know why? Because you're not planning to prevent crime. There should be an increase in relation to the crime intelligence budget because you need to produce intelligence product, predict crime, and be able to combat it, including GBV. You must have informants within families. You must put them on the payroll who are going to report on the uncles, the fathers that are raping children and women, that are beating women inside households. There are a lot of feared and known families in this country. Police fear them. Politicians don't talk about them. They are known, and some of them run assassination networks. A criminal can live a maximum security prison in South Africa, go kill somebody, be paid, and go back to prison. There is no strategy in this APP to speak to that. The embeddedness of the correctional service, the SAPS, crime intelligence, in the criminal activities in this country. The reason why we've got the dramatic levels of crime is because the police themselves are part of the criminals. In Johannesburg, we are in control of GMPD. The SAPS don't support the work of GMPD. If you get a person now with drugs, you hand them over to those dilapidated police stations of yours. You meet them on the other street, the same people. When you go ask them, we've just handed you criminals with drugs on their hands, you find that now it's baking powder. Because the police stations of South Africa under your watch are embedded in criminal activities. We can't support this budget. You have failed. And you are still going to fail because you are not planning to prevent crime, number one. Number two, the entire police force needs to be disarticulated from being embedded with criminals. We can't support this budget, and we call on our people to reject it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable Member.
All right. So, yeah, guys, the questions and the direction of the MK party, MK party as well as EFF, I'm quite satisfied with where we're going so far. I've looked at, I'm going to be playing some of the videos. In fact, I've been watching quite a number of their videos, Nje. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if maybe we should talk about this. Have you watched some of their videos? If you did, how did you find them, right? How was it? Was it, were you excited to see some of those things? How did you view their performance so far? For me, I'll definitely give them five out of five because as an opposition party, without the majority, obviously you don't have that much power that is needed. You know what I'm saying? So you must also think of them from that perspective that they don't have the power. The DA and the ANC have the majority. So they decide, and whatever they decide is going to happen either. They have complained. I looked at one of their videos in Parliament today where they were complaining about some inconsistency. For instance, they were given a document today, expected to make a decision today about a document that they were given today. Now, you all know that in business, guys, or when you have to make serious decisions, you don't make decisions like that. You sit, you think, you relax. For instance, people who are aware of their finances, I'm not talking about other people who get excited, but no, look, people who know and understand their finances, they don't get excited by being approved at a dealership and they quickly go and get a car. No, they go to the dealership, they understand how it works, they get approved, they still relax. Even after being approved and they understand the deal that they are being given, that's why they are able to go and negotiate better interest because they don't allow their emotions. That's how proper decisions are made, and that's what EFF and MK Party is applying there to say, you can't give us a document today and expect us to sign this document today and expect us to agree on that document today. That is not going to happen, not over our dead body, not now. That is what we are seeing with the MK Party and EFF. So like in business, guys, it does happen where a proposal is put on the table and a person says, give me time to think about it. That is business. People who are normal, people who understand that for one to make a decision, you will need to sit down and look, calculate. You understand what I'm saying? But when it's always suspicious when a person, for instance, okay, it's always suspicious when a person wants you to make a decision now. You all know that that's a scam. That's how people get scammed, by the way. When they want you to make a decision now, you must know there's something wrong about that thing. So what I'm trying to say is, normal people, when they make decisions, take a time to look at these things, look at the loopholes, look at the advantage, and make that decision. So, DA and ANC, they gave them document today and say, look at it now. That right there, they flagged it as a, they said, there's a red flag right there. You can't be telling us to decide now. And I was like, I commend them, guys. Let's give them credit. Let's give credit when it is true, guys. These people understand what they are doing. They are working under pressure. They can't make decisions, and their decision can be overrided. Despite the fact that they are not the majority, but they are able to pose the necessary questions. They are able to ask for the necessary, like they are able to, create a serious conversation. They are able to pinpoint some discrepancy in how they are being approached. For instance, if you look at the DA, and that when the ANC had the majority, that I've never seen such thing happen where a minister walks in there and start giving his speech in a total Afrikaans, right, without an interpreter. I've never seen it before. They've always respected Parliament. But now that their friends are there, the DA friend, the friends, their DA are there, they just do as they please, right? Whether these people understand or not, do you see something like that? But under such circumstances, but these guys were able to quickly adjust and understand what is needed now. And they play into that, look into that very nicely. And somebody started speaking in isiZulu. The other one speaking in Sitsonga. The other one, I think, was speaking in Xhosa. Look at the white lady there. What do you mean? Now, So you wouldn't. So if that's the case, then why would you allow your language to reign supreme over other people's language? Should have respect to other people. And that's how the majority of these guys, that's how they just taught them. Good, listen, if you think we're going to do that, oh, it's fine. Fair. Let's go. Bamlanda ngesiXhosa, bamlanda ngesiZulu, bamlanda ngelokho. Wangahlanganelo ngamuzwe evuma. Like this person, she agreed on something that wasn't necessarily, they were not saying that a person who would have heard them and understood them, that person would have acted or would have said something. But because she doesn't understand that, she just looked at the body language and then make her calculation and thought they were saying what she thought they were saying. And actually somebody stood up later on and made and reminded her that no, basically the reason you are in this situation is because you can't even tell what these people were saying. Why? Because there's no interpreter here. And she agreed. She agreed and said, nah, I agree with you. So what I'm trying to say is that it is very surprising that the DA had applied that methodology to even allow a person to speak in Afrikaans whilst there's no interpreter. Maybe it does happen in some of the places, but in Parliament, for instance, where laws are made, where people are supposed to be seen and seen to be free, now you wanna oppress them right in Parliament. But great, look, let's congratulate the thinking of those leaders who made the most out of that situation. MK Party, EFF. I wouldn't know if maybe ATM also they helped in that situation. I wouldn't know. I don't wanna lie. Maybe I'm not giving them credit when it is true. I'll be sorry if that happened. Nevertheless, see you guys on the next one.